Warning, the following video contains disturbing content that may not be appropriate for some viewers. You have been warned. Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to my YouTube channel, Gang Gang, period. Today guys, we're gonna be smoking, you know, out of the bong. It's a little dirty, but you know, who gives a fuck as long as we're smoking and getting lit. You know, since my last video, you guys, I'll also be doing my makeup, and you know, if you're interested in the products that I'm using, you know, once again, I'll be showing you, or just try to, you know, eye it all on your own. Cheers. All right, you guys already know what time it is, so let's go ahead and get started with this motherfucking video. You guys, this story is intense. If you think the last video was crazy, this video is 10 times crazier. It's sad and it's just really intense. I'm sure you guys have heard about this story before. It has been, so let's go ahead and get started. This story is about Gabriel Fernandez. Gabriel Fernandez was born on February 20, 2005 to Arnold Contreras and Pearl Fernandez. You guys, Gabriel's upbringing, you know, during his childhood, it wasn't the best just because his dad was incarcerated, but throughout his entire childhood, his, you know, upbringing is just never got better. Shortly after Pearl Fernandez giving birth to Gabriel Fernandez, he was put into custody of his great uncle on his mother's side with Michael Carranza and his partner David Martinez. They continued to raise Gabriel for 4 years in 2009. You know, they would actually take care of him, you know, play with him, take him out. Like, he was just, like, in good hands, you know. 4-year-old Gabriel moved in with his grandparents, both Sandra and Robert Fernandez. It's due to his grandfather objecting to Carranza's and, you know, Martinez's same-sex relationship since he was gay. He lived with his grandparents until 2012. Gabriel had 2 siblings and attended first grade at Summer Wayne Elementary School, where his teacher was Jennifer Garcia. She described, you know, Gabriel as a kind child who enjoyed going to school. He loved going to school. So let me go ahead and tell you a little bit of Pearl Fernandez, which is Gabriel's mother. She was born on August 29, 1983 to Robert and Sandra Fernandez. During her childhood, her father was in and out of jail, and you know, Pearl has claimed that her mother did not love her and would hurt her and would hit her as a child. At the age of 9, Pearl began using methamphetamine and drinking alcohol at the age of 11. Pearl decided to run away from home. She dropped out of school at the 8th grade. As a teenager, Pearl claimed that her uncle attempted to rape her and that some men had held her hostage for a period of days, taking turns raping her, which led to her having, you know, suicidal thoughts. It's just, her upbringing is just crazy. You know, she ended up in the hospital. She was recovering. She has 4 children with Arnold Contreras, including Gabriel. When Gabriel was born, she abandoned him at the hospital, you guys, 3 days after his birth. However, she did regain custody of Gabriel in 2012. Pearl was, you know, she has been diagnosed with several mental health issues, including depressive disorder, developmental disability, and a possible personality disorder and post-traumatic stress disorder. In 2011, Fernandez, she took a cognitive ability test scoring in the 3rd percent in the verbal comprehension portion of the test, which is one part of a, you know, typical second grade student. Her clinical psychologist, Deborah, you know, she stated that Pearl is virtually unable to use thoughts to guide her own behavior and control her emotion reactions. So now let me go ahead and tell you a little bit of Isidro Aguirre, also known as Tony Aguirre. He was born on June 13, 1980. Aguirre repeated 2 grades in school and ultimately dropped off, implying a possible learning disability. He worked for Woodland Park Retirement Hotel, where he was a caregiver and a driver. executive director of the retirement home and former boss of Ayede. Susan Whisper described him as a quiet, down-to-earth, nice person, always willing to help. She also commented that throughout his 3 years of employment, he was patient and loving and would commonly change the diapers of elderly residents at the facility. Staff at the facility, they gave him a nickname, Shaggy, which was, according to Wastebarth, a team referring his endowment ex-coworker, Charlene Mile, who also worked for William Park Retirement Hotel, noted that while Akira was driving residents, he would often drive them the scenic route so they could, you know, get to see other views other than just the freeway. In October 2012, Agueda began working as a security guard for a private security. He worked at the Vallarta Market in Ponte, California. Agueda, he met Pearl roughly a year and a half or up to 2 years before they took custody of Gabriel Fernandez. So in 2012, when custody of Gabriel was given to his mother and her boyfriend, despite concerns of his welfare expressed by the family throughout his 8-month stay in the household, Gabriel was abused and tortured. So despite, like, basically she wanted just to get Gabriel to gain welfare benefits, you know, she was still given the custody, you know, despite the concerns of the family who has been taking care of Gabriel. You know, they said that she was, like, neglectful towards other kids, you know. Gabriel then was moved in with his mother and her boyfriend, Isaro. The abuse included, it's just intense. The abuse included being forced to eat cat litter and feces, forced to eat his own vomit regularly, beaten, which caused broken bones, burned in various parts of the body, shot in various areas of the body with a BB gun, including the face and groin, forced to wear female clothing, forced to sleep bound and gagged in a small cupboard, pepper sprayed, burned with cigarettes, given with cold bath, forced to eat spoiled or expired foods, according to Fernandez's siblings. While Fernandez was being abused, his mother and stepfather would laugh. Agueda reportedly abused, you know, Gabriel because he believed he was homosexual. The abuse and torture did not extend to Fernandez's siblings. It was just only for Gabriel. Hey guys, this story is just intense. It's making me mad. It's just intense. Despite everything they did to Gabriel, that poor baby, you guys, he would still tell his mom that he loved her. You know, he's like, just, oh my god. You know, like, it's just intense. He would, like, you know, make things for his mom, little, like, for Mother's Day, little things, just cute little things. In the months preceding his death, Gabriel showed his injuries or reported the abuse to security guard, family members, and a teacher, which led to several calls to social services to no avail. After being hit with a metal belt, he asked his teacher, Ms. Garcia, if it's normal to bleed. In response, Ms. Garcia called social services and was later called by social worker Stephanie Rodriguez, informing her that she was assigned to the case. On another day, you know, Fernandez Gabriel came to class with chunks of hair missing and a lump on his lip with question about it by Garcia. Gabriel said his mother had punched him in the mouth after discussing with the principal. Ms. Garcia called Rodriguez back and informed her of the recent signs of abuse. Later, when, you know, Gabriel reported to his teacher that he was shot in the face with a BB gun by his mother, she once again informed social services of the new signs of abuse. After Gabriel missed 13 days of school, you guys, he returned and his teacher noticed his condition had worsened. She attempted to call Rodriguez, but her call was never returned. Gabriel grieved Aunt Elizabeth Carranza, and her husband called social services 3 times and talked to sheriffs 2 times regarding the welfare of Fernandez. 29 days before his death, a security guard, Arturo Miranda Martinez, at a Los Angeles County Welfare Office noticed extensive injuries on Gabriel's body, which prompted him to call 911, risking his job to report the injuries to sheriffs. Overall, between 2005 and 2012, 60 complaints were filed against Pearl Fernandez and Aguirre to the Los Angeles County Department of Child and Family Services. 2 social workers, Stephanie Rodriguez and Patricia Clement, and 2 supervisors, Kevin Boom and Gregory Merritt, for the Los Angeles County Department of Children and Family Services, were fired and charged with child abuse and falsifying public records. The unprecedented charges held significant consequences, including up to 11 years in prison. However, these charges were, they were dismissed by the California 2nd District Court of Appeal for lack of probable cause. In January 2020, prosecutors attempted to get a rehearing for the case, but eventually decided to drop the charges. Additionally, 9 sheriff's deputies were internally disciplined for not properly investigating the abuse allegations. This baby, he tried to reach, he tried to save his own life, and the system failed him. A lot of people failed him. Social workers failed him. Like, if you're gonna be a social worker, do your fucking job. It's so annoying. On May 22, 2013, Pearl Fernandez called 911 to report that her child, Gabriel, was not breathing. Gabriel had been fatally beaten by his mother, and Aguirre, after failing to clean up his toys. Come on, really? When first responders arrived, they found him on the ground, naked with several injuries. Aguirre explained to them that, Gabriel was gay, I guess. Despite the information being irrelevant, paramedics rushed him to the hospital where doctors declared him brain dead. He passed away 2 days later on May 24, 2013 at the Children's Hospital, Los Angeles. He died at the age of 8 years old. What the fuck? And the official autopsy declared that he died of blunt force trauma and coincided with neglect and malnutrition. What the fuck? On May 23rd, 2013, Pearl Fernandez and Isauro Aguirre, they were both arrested. Pearl was arrested for felony child endangerment, while Aguirre was arrested for attempted murder. However, when Gabriel Fernandez died, Pearl and Aguirre were both charged with first-degree murder with special circumstances of torture. Prosecutors pursued the death penalty. Isauro Aguirre, he pleaded not guilty to the charges of first-degree murder, with special circumstances of torture, and the case was prosecuted by Deputy District Attorney John Hatami and Deputy District Attorney Scott Yang. When the trial began, jurors were given details about the extensive abuses about Gabriel Fernandez, what he went through in the months preceding his fatal, beating. Prosecutor John Hatami called Aguirre pure evil and argued that he deserved the death penalty, even though it doesn't even compare to what he did to Gabriel. And to be honest, I agree with him. He deserves the fucking death penalty. You do not deserve, to be even incarcerated. You just need to be gone. Aguirre's defense attorney, Don Allen, you guys, he argued that Aguirre was actually, he was considered to be nice and compassionate during his employment at the retirement facility, that he liked helping people, and he was just, a good guy, way before, meeting Pearl Fernandez. He never committed any crime or anything. Pretty much, I'm guessing he's trying to blame Pearl for, making him do things, but I'm pretty sure they both agreed on to torture this poor baby. Like, what kind of mother does that to, like, her own child? And then bringing a fucking man into your life to, like, beat on your child basically to death and, like, make him eat cat litter, his own vomit, rotten food? Like, how? Like, oh my, like, are you stupid? Like, oh my gosh. It's, like, you are a sicko. Like, I'm happy they caught both of y'all, and y'all motherfuckers are in motherfucking prison, probably dead now, but, I mean, justice, I guess. So, the jury deliberation began on November 14, 2017, and a verdict was reached the next afternoon. Ultimately, the jury found him guilty of first-degree murder and guilty of the circumstances of torture charges. On December 11, 2017, jury deliberation began for the sentencing phase. The next day, the jury was deadlocked. However, on December 13, they decided to recommend the death penalty, which was actually accepted by the judge, George Lomeli. He was sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. Aguirre was sentenced to the death penalty without the possibility of parole for the death of Gabriel Fernandez.